Sri Jayalakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the Hindu Academy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri Lakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
The topic I'm going to take on today is the topic which is very important for us to understand, scriptures. Now, all religions, suppose you wanted to learn about a religion, where should you go? The first place of call should be those individuals who say, religion is a matter of experience for me. I'm a rishi. I see what I'm talking about is something that I experience. This God and Atman stuff, I know. It's the first place of call. And these people are called, these are the founders of Hinduism, people of authority called rishi, R-I-S-H-I. But they're very difficult to find. So the second place where you can perhaps learn about your religion is through what they have left behind, what they have said, what they have taught. And this becomes the holy texts or the scriptures of all world religions. What these holy people are talking about their experience, etc. Now the Hindu scriptures are divided into two categories. This is very important. Most of us don't know there are two different categories of Hindu scriptures. One category is called the scripture of authority, and they are called the the Sanskrit word is Shruti, from the Sanskrit root Shrutva. Shrutva means that which has been heard. So it's, how do you mean, why do you call it Shrutva? The reason is very likely, for thousands of years, this knowledge was passed on as an oral tradition. It was not written down until very recently, about 2,500 years ago. So initially, for thousands of years, these teachings were passed on from one generation to the next generation by word of mouth. They memorized the whole Shrutis and they passed on to the next generation. They used to memorize every. So the Shruti, the word comes from Shrutva, that which is heard. These are the scripture of authority of Hinduism. Remember, authority. And the books are called Vedas, from the Sanskrit root Vida. Vid means to know. And these are books of knowledge. Knowledge not about just ordinary things, but knowledge about what is the nature of reality, what is this all about. So these are called Vedas, from the root Vida. And these, remember, are called Shrutis, and these are the scriptures of authority of Hinduism. Authority. Okay? Now within the Vedas are very, very elaborate, very long. Early part of the Vedas are literally nothing more than hymns to the forces of nature, Vayu and Indra and Agni and so on. They are hymns devoted to the forces of nature, the first portion of the Veda. But the second portion of the Veda focuses on the liturgy, the kind of rituals you have to do in the name of religion. But the most important part of the Vedas, the third portion, are called the Upanishad. Now they come in the end part of the Vedas, in the Aranyak, they are called Aranyak. You don't need to learn all these words. The Upanishads are the very important aspect, because they contain the philosophic heart of Hinduism, Upanishada. The word Upanishada is derived from Sanskrit. Upa means come near, shad means I destroy. So you're going to come near and destroy, this is terrible. The word Upanishad means come near, I will destroy your delusion regarding what is the nature of reality, what is this all about, who are you? You say, I know, but they say, oh no, come near, I'll show you who you truly are, or what is the nature of this world that we live in. This is the meaning of the word Upanishad. This is the philosophic heart of Hinduism, scripture of authority, philosophic, highly dramatic, material, fantastic material. This is where you discover the words like Atman or Brahma. Atman is the English where they pronounce it, a Brahman, where they pronounce it, they put an N at the end of it, is Brahma. So Atma and Brahma, the ideas of Atma, Brahma, etc. are fully explored in the Vedas, in the philosophic part of Vedas called the Upanishad. What do they talk about? They talk about the nature of reality. What is all this about? Our own essential nature and the essential nature of the world that we see in front of us. They say the essential nature that we possess is Atman, spirit. We are something special, different from matter, not body, mind, or we are something special, and the word is Atma, spirit. And they say the nature of reality, this world, you see all the galaxies, is also unusual. It is Brahma. It is something dramatically different from what it appears. It is essentially the spirit manifesting as the creation. So they talk about this philosophic heart of Hinduism, Atma, Brahman, and the relationship between Atma and Brahman. This is what the philosophic texts of Hinduism do. These are in the Upanishads. These are the scriptures of authority of the Hindus. Remember that. This is one strand of Hinduism, one strand of scriptures of Hindus, and this is where the authority lies. Remember, every time you are in difficulty, fall back on the authority. Otherwise, you are in. That's why I say it's a very important session for you to make the distinction. The second set of scriptures we possess are called the Smriti scriptures. Smriti. Now, don't worry about the vocabulary, because then the wording is there, because you'll get it yourself as we go along. The important thing about the Smritis are this. The philosophic ideas that we discussed in the Upanishads are very difficult to digest or to understand. They're very subtle, like Atma, Brahma. How do you understand this? What is it? You look, what is it? You go, what is spirit? What do you mean by that? They're very difficult ideas to swallow or to become accessible or digestible. So we create a whole mass of secondary scriptures. Secondary scriptures means less authority than the Shrutis. They are called the Smriti scriptures. In the Smriti scriptures, what do they contain? First of all, the word Smriti means something that has been, if you like, in memory of. That's what the word Smriti means. So somebody has composed this Smriti scripture. So in the memory of that person, we are saying these are Smriti scriptures. And they are of lower authority. Remember, not they are not useless. They are secondary scriptures of less authority than the Shrutis. Now, the Smriti scriptures contain the following. First of all, there are two major stories. The Hindus claim are historic stories, means they actually happened, not just made up. And these two major stories, big stories, are called epics. Big stories called epic. And the two major epics of the Hindu tradition are, of course, most of you will know, are the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. These are the two epics, or they're like the major stories of Hindus. And they have been the reason why most of you are here today. Because these stories of Ramayana and Mahabharata drew you and linked you up with your religion. So these are very powerful stories. They become part of the Smriti scripture. These are perhaps the best ones, because they have got historic foundation. They're just purely made up. They've got historic background. But please be careful. As thinking youngsters, please remember, even the Smriti scriptures were passed on through word of mouth over thousands of years, even the Ramayana and the Mahabharata stories, and every time the story is told and retold, bits are added and bits are taken away. So sometimes when you get a version of Ramayana and Mahabharata, you say, this can't have happened. It may be an exaggeration. Be careful. Even the stories of Ramayana and Mahabharata, which we say are historic stories, they actually happen, there may be bits and pieces which are addition and subtraction. So when something happens, when you hear something, you say, this doesn't make sense, just use your common sense and decide whether this exaggeration will actually happen. We leave it to you. I won't tell you. You think for yourself. So this is why Ramayana and Mahabharata, even though they have historic foundation, they come with exaggeration. So be careful. Be very careful. Don't get. Always be ready to say, this can't have happened. And you're allowed to think like that. Then we, apart from the Ramayana and Mahabharata, the two epics, which we call our historic stories, we've got 18 Mahapurana, 18 others, legendary. Puran means legendary stories. We've got 18 of those, huge ones, Maha, big ones, Puran. Puran literally means legendary. Now you see, again, they appear very, when you say Puran, that means it's legendary. You can't say history actually happened. You can't say that. Literally, you can't say that. But many Hindus are fixated. They say, it actually happened, Mr. Lakhani. Don't, how dare you? I say, look, I'm telling you, it's called legendary. If you say it actually happened, you are in big trouble with the scientists, with the philosophers, with the thinkers, with the rationalists. So be aware these are legendary stories, then you are safe. Otherwise you are in big trouble. Your common sense will hit you. Won't allow you to swallow stuff like that. So once you know it has got legendary foundation, then you say, well, it's legendary. Take it as you like. Colorful storytelling, so be it. And you've got lots of them. We aren't frightened of them. We use them because we like, look, you may think legendary stories are outdated, old-fashioned. We still use legendary story today. You say, where? The old mythology was, you know, lovely Purans and all these lovely stories. You know what's the modern mythology? And you all love it? Star Wars, Superman, X-Men, you know, all this stuff. This is modern mythology. And there are some Americans who actually think that actually happens. Star Wars actually happened. They believe that. And say, grow up. Is this the story? This is modern mythology. So the same thing you're hearing from old stories with good over evil, etc., is now presented in modern terms as if you like science fiction mythology. And we swallow it. We love Harry Potter and all this magic and all this stuff. You know, it can't have happened. All these broomsticks and flying about and all that. And yet we love it. Just as we loved ancient mythology, don't be frightened to love modern mythology. Same old story, good over evil, courage and valor and intelligence and using it to fight the evil, well, wonderful stuff. But given if you like more scientific approach, more if you like suitable approach for the youngsters today to digest. If I tell the youngsters, oh, this is old mythology story of Hindus, they say, no. Star Wars, yeah, we love this. Harry Potter, yeah. So this is how, if you like, human beings evolve. Nothing wrong, don't be frightened by this. Just learn the importance of storytelling and how it is to evolve old stories and new stories. So if this is the second part of the Smriti scripture, the two epics which we say are literal, historic, that's 18 Mahapurans, storytelling, colorful storytelling. Then we've got something else in the Smriti scripture which is a bit worrying, and this is why we need to tidy up. The Smriti scriptures also contain law books. Law books means kind of some kind of prescription saying this is how society should behave, this is how the king should behave, this is how the family member should behave, the father should treat the children like this and the children must respect the father like this. These are kind of codes of conduct for society, law books. Again, they become part of the Smriti scripture. Now these law books are contextual, means they must change with the time and place. They're not fixated, you must do this or you're hell, go to hell. We don't talk like that. So the law books of the Hindus come with a very clear warning that they are contextual. They can change depending on the time and place. So what was suitable 1,000 years ago is not suitable today. They'll say, yes, it's not suitable. Make your own law books now. You know, find new codes of conduct for society, for families to adopt. So the law books come, and these are called shastras, and there are injunctions and all sorts of stuff, weird stuff there. And some of them are completely irrelevant in the world that we live in. So you must be able to be rational enough, to be robust enough to say, no, this may be suitable 1,000 years ago in India, it's not suitable for India today or for us in UK today. This is, if you like, the law books of the Hindus. And I tell you one glaring example why it's a serious issue. You see, some of these law books, ancient law books, one of the ones that they love to put in the syllabus is called the Manu Smriti, Manu Smriti. Now, Manu Smriti is a very ancient book that the Hindus did use over a certain period of time. It's completely outdated, and we have moved away from it. None of you will have Manu Smriti in your house now, I guarantee. We don't have it, we don't think it's important. And yet it is, if you like, because it was in the ancient books, the Western academics love to hang on to it, say, this is Hinduism. It's called rubbish in the sense it's not suited to the times that we live in. And you say, no, it is there. We say, it is not there. And one glaring example is this. It is the idea of a hereditary, hierarchical caste system. That you are born either as superior or inferior or outcast, means you are not even human. This comes in Manu Smriti. But we've grown out of it long time ago. We have stopped using it for over 500 years at least. So why are they insisting this is Hinduism? We said we've used it a long time ago, it's outdated, we don't use it anymore. So hereditary hierarchical caste system is one of these teachings. That means you are by birth you are upper or lower or outcast, and you are only fit to do certain professions. This comes in the Manu Smriti. It is outdated scripture. Law book which is outdated. So what is the definition of a caste? I'll just give an example, you see how it's touching. One of the scriptures of authority, like the Vedas, will say caste simply means you must try and fulfill certain function in society depending on your own ability. Suppose I'm very brainy, I'm clever, I must become a scientist surely. Suppose I just love to do physical work, then you must do physical work. Doesn't mean you're upper or lower, or this is already fixed because you're born in that family. So the division of labor based on your ability is the only idea of caste in the scripture of authority, the Vedas. But in the scripture of less authority, like the Smriti, like Manu Smriti, they say, oh no, it's already fixed. By birth you are fixed, you have to be only this. It's an outdated idea which does not agree with us whatsoever. So this is the distinction between the Shruti and the Smriti. Make this distinction. I'll just give one other example. I'll talk about it in a minute. Now, here we've got the Shruti, the scripture of authority, philosophic, and all this talking about nature of reality as Atman and Brahman. And you've got the Smriti scripture, colorful gods and goddesses coming in there, interacting. And then there is one particular text that all the Hindus swear by. It's neither the Vedas, nor the Purans, nor the epics. And that book that all the Hindus swear by is called the Bhagavad Gita. So you need to know about Gita, just a little bit. So why is Gita so crucial? It occurs in the story of Mahabharata. So it is in the Smriti scripture, a conversation between Arjun and Krishna in the story of Mahabharata. So it's Smriti scripture, and yet the material it contains is not just colorful storytelling, it is the highest philosophy. So the Bhagavad Gita contains the teachings of the Upanishads, which was very in the Vedas, the scripture of authority, and yet it appears in the story of Mahabharata as a conversation, dialogue between Arjuna and Krishna. This is why this is a very powerful script. In the Smriti scripture, and yet the power of Shruti, Bhagavad Gita is the most powerful book the Hindus use, as if you like, the main scripture of the Hindus. Why is it such an important book? Let me tell you a few things about the Bhagavad Gita. First of all, the word Gita means a song. Bhagavad means a song of the divine. This is what it literally means. There are about 700 verses in 18 chapters. But why is it so touching? And why do all the Hindus subscribe to, whether you are from Gujarat or from Tamil Nadu, wherever, you love Bhagavad Gita? Why? Because it shows the comprehensive nature of Hinduism, the vastness of Hinduism. In one text, in that little book, you get all the variation of Hindu ideas combined, joined up nicely together. He says, you want to be spiritual? You like devotion to God? Okay, devote your life to God. This is called the Bhakti Marg. Oh, no, I'm an intellectual. Okay, then think about Atman and Brahman. This is your way. You can follow that path. Oh, no, I like to meditate. That's your way, Bhagavad Gita. Oh, no, I like to be active in society. I like to do selfless work. I like to be a charitable. I do exciting things for society, for goodness. Good, that's your way, Karma Marg. It allows this variety of different ideas to coexist. Pick and choose, like you go to the sweet shop and do pick and choose all the sweets you like. Here also it says, oh, every individual can pick and choose which way they want to be spiritual. And pick and choose and mix and match what appeals to your own temperament and make progress. This is the book of comprehensive pluralism, many ways to be spiritual, many ways to think about religion and God. This is why the Gita is so powerful. It is philosophically very sound. It talks about Atman and Brahman, God is a principle. It talks about God as a personality. It talks about God as humanity. So all these ideas are incorporated in just simple text called the Bhagavad Gita. That's why it's called the scripture of authority. And this is very crucial. And I'll just touch on the caste issue. For example, in the Smriti scripture, they'll say you are a Brahmin if you are born in a Brahmin family. In the Bhagavad Gita, in the chapter 18, do you know how they define the Brahmin? They say a Brahmin is a person, just think about it, doesn't say you're born in a Brahmin family. A Brahmin is defined as that person who is truthful by nature. He's a poor chap, can't lie. He just can't lie. He just loves to be truthful. He can't help himself. He's truthful by nature. Content means he doesn't go chasing after this and that. He's very content. And the third most important, he leads a spiritual life, a God-centered life, not material life. I have more money, how much money? Oh, I like to think about spiritual, higher things. Any person who is truthful by nature, content, and leads a spiritual life or a God-centered life is defined as a Brahmin in chapter 18 of the Bhagavad Gita. See the definition of Brahmin, not born in a Brahmin family. And the Bhagavad Gita said, these are the people, in fact, whole of humanity should try and become like that. Become like that, spiritual. This is the teaching of Bhagavad Gita. See the definition? So anybody, you can go outside in the street, you may meet an Englishman who is very honest and truthful and very content and very spiritual. You say, you are a Brahmin, Bhagavad Gita. He says, I'm not a Brahmin. This is what it says. And they say, anybody who is like this is fit to be a religious teacher, to become, kind of do religious rituals, to do, if you like, all these kind of, you know, kind of give good ideas in society, etc., advisor, is somebody who is kind of spiritually oriented. This is why the Brahmin is considered to be respected. These are people who are wise people, who are leading spiritual life. That is why they are respected, not because they are born in a Brahmin family. So this, if you like, the depth of the Shruti scripture, if you like, even the Bhagavad Gita, is a powerful thought. You see the distinction straight away. This is why you must pay tribute to the more philosophic ideas of Hinduism contained in the Shruti scriptures rather than the Smriti scriptures, which are outdated. And we have stopped using them a long time ago, except these people want us to still hang on to it. Because it shows Hinduism in poor light. Anyway, I've touched on quite a few ideas in the Shruti and the Smriti scripture. This basically covers what you require to know about the Hindu scriptures.
When we pray to God, how do we know that God can see us praying to Him?
Okay. You see, suppose you are very devout. Let me be very honest. Suppose you're very devout. You like to think of spirituality, religion in a personalized manner. Nothing wrong, eh? It's a nice way of thinking about spirituality. Focusing on one personality. So when you look at the image of Shiva, I love Shiva. I just love him. I don't know why. I love him. If you are actually fixated like that and you love God as a personality, look, I'm not saying it's wrong. This is the way you become spiritual. So you use the idea of God as a personality, and then how do you know he's listening? Because you make him listen. You are the creator of that personality, and that creator, that personality will listen to you. Suppose I'm really, really, you know, very keen on thinking of God as Shiva, then I'm telling you, when I pray to Shiva, he will listen, because I'll make him listen. He's my creation, I make him listen. There's a nice story in the Puran, you see the colorful storytelling. A story about, you know, this guy called Dhruva, who wanted to see God as Vishnu. It's a colorful story, but a very powerful philosophic idea in it. So poor little Dhruva, little chap, kept repeating the name of Om Namo Narayana, and finally Vishnu appeared, said, no, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudeva, he kept repeating. And then Vishnu appeared. My boy, I'm here. And Dhruva looked at, ah, so wonderful. Then he looked at Vishnu's form, you know, forearms and all that. And then Dhruva asked one very pointed question. He said, Vishnu, why is your kundal, you know, this ear piece is not kind of tinkling? Why are they kind of steady? They're not moving. And Vishnu answered, my boy, you created me like this. You make them move. You make them move. This is in the story of Dhruva. It shows the philosophic idea. We generate an image of God and he becomes that for us. He's such a lovely chap. This thing called Brahman takes on the form of your desire. I want to see God as my mommy, my mother goddess. And God becomes a mother goddess and stands in front of you and plays with you and talks to you and dances with you. This is reality of Hindu tradition. It is true. So if you're fixated on the idea of thinking God is a personality, this grand thing called Brahman will take that form and come in front of you and interact with you in a dynamic way. Wow! So you don't just make believe. You actually can experience God as a personality if you want that to happen.
When smithies are produced, will they only come with a disclaimer about the Shruti or philosophical ideas?
All the smithies. It's a very good question. The smrutis actually, when you look at the smruti, read the smrutis, they come with the health warning right at the start. This must take into account the desh and kaal, the time and the place you live in. And it is not fixated. You mustn't be fixated on the smrutis. The smrutis come with a health warning. They're not just, I'm making it up now. All the smrutis say, these are books suited to our time and this place. Not necessary forever. So the stuff that was suitable in India 1,000 years ago is definitely not necessarily suitable for the world that we live in the United Kingdom 1,000 years after. But who decides? You decide. Why should I decide? You think for yourself. Are they still relevant? Are the ideas of Smriti still relevant? Like I just told you, the mythology of ancient times, suppose I do the stories of all these lovely colorful gods and goddesses. You know, they may have suited the mind of ancient Hindus, but today these youngsters here, they prefer Harry Potter. How can I stop it? See, it is necessary for the smrutis to evolve with the times. They're like this technological fighting rather than antiquated fighting of bows and arrows. So be it. So this is, if you like, the codes of conduct you use in your family or your society must also change, must take into account the evolution in humanity, and so should the colorful storytelling.
How are the Abrahamic faiths different from the Indic faiths? Yes.
The Abrahamic faiths are fixated on God in heaven, all three of them, Judaism, Christianity, Islam. The religion cannot exist unless there is a God. They are fixated on a super personality. Now you may think that's all right, you know, that's the way many Hindus like to think God as Vishnu, Shiva, nothing wrong. But the problem is this, we live in modern times, which is very science-oriented, rational world. Now here the problem arises. This is how the problem arises. They are in trouble. All Abrahamic tradition are in trouble. Why? The moment you say God is almighty, all-knowing, and all-compassionate, three qualities, all religions will give, all the Abrahamic will say, God is almighty, all-knowing, all-compassionate. Oh, wonderful. Then Richard Dawkins will come and say, come here, look around. See the living kingdom, animals, insects, they are each killing and biting each other while they're alive. Haven't you seen the Discovery Channel? They kill each other while they're alive. They're munching each other while they're alive. Insects, animals, not 100, not million, not billion, trillions. So Richard Dawkins says, if you say God created this, he's a nasty chap. Why should you worship him? That is why they become, they don't say, we are not sure about God, they say, we are sure there is no God. They are called atheists. Do you blame them? So idea of God as a super personality is in very serious trouble in this century. It won't survive this century. That's why, you see, the churches are being abandoned. No youngsters, go to any church, no youngster will be there. They can't relate to a God anymore. In fact, the only way to relate to God is to make fun of him. You know, take the mickey out of God. Look at all the TV programs. In the name of religion, they take the mickey out of it, because they think it's nonsense, can't be real. So monotheism is in real trouble. The idea of a super personality, I'm creator, is in trouble. Because of all the suffering all around. You can't run away from it. You can give excuses, but there's a cop-out. So the thinking youngsters say, rather not believe this. That is why the Abrahamic traditions are stuck in a rut because of monotheism linked to a god. What about the Indic tradition? We come in two flavors, I warned you. And the flavor that is kind of philosophically acceptable, the Shruti scripture, has no difficulty. There is no god there. Just talking of spirit manifesting, appearing in the creation. So there's no god, nobody to catch. You see, when this thing becomes visible as living things, it's got a habit of biting itself and killing each other. This is not a god to blame. That is why it's safe, philosophically safe, because it's a principle-oriented religion, not a personality-oriented religion. That is why it's not even called a religion. Religion means aligning whole of humanity to God. We don't say, no, we say dharma. What the heck is all this? That's all you're making sense of, not looking for a god. That is why it's safe. Even I talk like this at Eton or wherever top colleges, I don't get challenged. They fall in love. It's a good idea. Because there's nobody to catch and say, okay, how can you believe nonsense like that? There's no nonsense. Looking deeper reality, what is all this about? Answer that. That's what we're all about. That's why we're very safe. Not only safe. That is why the BBC won't let me get through.
Why do people think of God as with a personality and characteristics that is exaggerated as humans?
You see, this idea of getting fixated on a super personality, it's like human, but superhuman. It's somehow, if you like, our problem. Why? Because we are human beings. And in order for us to get a handle on what are these people, the only way we can get a handle on this idea of something greater than just human is to make it superhuman. It is, if you like, a human trait. We can't help it, it's a human characteristics. So if I'm little compassionate, I say, let me think of somebody who's all compassionate, he's all loving everything and everybody, even the nasty people, he loves them. Let me exaggerate. So what happens that because we are human, the only way we can get a handle on this idea of religion is to think about a superhuman. This is why we create all these super personalities with so many arms and all that, so many heads and all that. We are exaggerating human features, human attributes, which are the good ones, not the bad ones. The good ones, to try and relate to the idea of who are we, what is all this about. So we exaggerate the things already here. Like, you know, search for knowledge, search for, you know, kind of thirsty for knowledge, or being compassionate, or being empowered. I don't like to be pushed about. That's a natural thing for every living thing. So we exaggerate all these things. Oh, Lord, you are all powerful, you are all knowing, you are all compassionate. So you see, if you like human feature, in order to first understand it, we say exaggerate. And this is how we produce the God, or all these colorful gods and goddesses. They are human aspirations. Like, suppose I want to be learned, then I think of God. God, not a person, like a God is a mother goddess, Saraswati. She'll give me all the knowledge, music, art, everything comes from Saraswati. So I look at these ideas and project it on Saraswati and think of God as Saraswati. It's a human way of understanding the idea of religion. Nothing wrong with it.
Why do people experience near-death experiences?
Okay. You see, a lot of people are fascinated by exotic things that we kind of come across, like the near-death experience, because we are not sure whether we're going to be reincarnated, is real or not. But near-death experience is something that happens around the clock. Thousands, that I think 2,000 cases in Southampton University of near-death experience in the local hospitals. That's huge. So near-death experience is kind of quite common. So why does it happen? You see, we know that there's something more to us than the body. So when the body stops functioning, something seems to continue to exist. That is why it's exciting, because they thank God we are not just going to die. You don't get snuffed out when the body dies. Something is going to continue to survive. That is why it's kind of drawing a lot of attention. So near-death experience is, because even you can be a crass atheist, I don't believe in God and religion. I say, okay, but this near-death experience, so many people are getting it. So what is going on there? So it's kind of become an exotic subject to explore. That is why people like it. And this is why, in a way, as human beings become more evolved, they say that it's not just because, you know, kicked out of one body, maybe we can get back into the body. So this is becoming more kind of frequent now. It's not because we are trying to do it. Human beings are evolving and are becoming conscious. They are more than the body, so they can go in and out of the body. That's why it's happening more often now.